बालगे भूमंडला बालगे भूमंडला बालगे समृद्धि ओंदिगे गुरु बालगे गुरु नम्मोंदिगे बी ब्लेस्ड बाय द डिवाइन बाय द ग्रेस ऑफ डिवाइन पावर मे द होल वर्ल्ड एंजॉय पीस प्रॉस्पेरिटी एंड हैप्पीनेस एंड विश द ग्रेस ऑफ डिवाइन फादर गुरु योगिराज वेदाद्रि महर्षि बी विथ अस फॉरएवर. Dear friends, it's our pleasure to heartily welcome all of you for today's Atma Sangama program organized by World Community Service Center, Karnataka Zone. I cordially welcome Dr. Vijaya Ganapati Madam for this program today in English. It's my pleasure to introduce Madam for this session. Madam has completed her Master of Arts in Philosophy. Madam is working as a secretary at Maharshi Aurobindo School. Madam is a Vice President of World Community Service Center, Karnataka Zone, Vice President of SMART, Karnataka Zone, and also a Vice President of Bangalore Panchashila Nagara Sky Trust, doing her service selflessly from past 27 years. Encouraging many Sky Masters, members, professors to practice Sky Yoga and guiding all of us to follow the principles of Guru Yogiraj Vedadri Maharshi. Now, I request Dr. Vijaya Ganapati Madam to invite the speaker of the day and introduce Dr. Malla Bhaskar Rao sir to all of us. Be blessed by the Divine Madam.
Balgi Bhumandala, Balgi Bhumandala, Balgi Samruddhi Undige. Be blessed by the Divine. I feel very happy and honored to introduce the prestigious speaker for today's evening Atma Sangama program, Mr. Dr. Malla Bhaskar Rao, a professor, Department of Neurosurgery, NIMHANS, Bangalore. So Dr. Malla Bhaskar Rao has secured his MBBS from the Andhra University, Visakhapatnam in 1985. He has also secured his Diplomat of National Board Neurosurgery from NBE of New Delhi in 1993. Is the FRCS Royal College of Surgeons of England, London in the year 2013. Is a Functional Neurosurgery Fellowship from Mayo Clinic, USA in 1995, from MNI Canada in 1995, from ARMC Australia 2000, and from KCH London 2001. Dr. Rao, along with Dr. Kurupat Radhakrishnan, established an outstanding epilepsy surgery program at Sri Chitra Thirunal Institute of Medical Science and Technology, Trivandrum, in 1995. He has expanded and improved the epilepsy surgery program at NIMHANS, Bangalore, since 2012. Dr. Rao has initiated epilepsy surgery programs at a number of other institutions in India, Sri Lanka, Middle East, and trained a number of residents and junior colleagues. Dr. Rao has published over 50 scientific papers in the peer-reviewed national and international journals. My dear friends, he has also got many awards such as the Young Investigator Award from International League Against Epilepsy in 1999. He has also received the Senior Research Scholar Award from the University of Melbourne, Australia 2000. And he also won the Commonwealth Fellowship Award from Association of Commonwealth Universities, London, UK in the year 2001. He has also won the Young Investigator Travel Award AES USA 2002 and from FRCS UK 2013. Dr. Rao is a member of the NSI, IEA, IES and AES. He is the president of the ISSFN, that is Indian Society of Stereotactic and Functional Neurosurgery, and continental vice president of the WSSFN. He has served the ILAE as a member of the committee to initiate epilepsy surgery in the developing countries. Dr. Rao is the principal investigator of two ongoing projects such as the Satyam and DST, which is related with the study of the effect of yoga and meditation on human brain. For nearly three decades, he has made a substantial contributions to the clinical service, postgraduate teaching and research in India. We are very happy to have the speaker today in this evening Atma Sangama program. I welcome him on behalf of the WCSC Karnataka Zone President and all the members. I also welcome all the participants for this program. Now I request Dr. Malla Bhaskar sir to deliver a speech on the brain health. Dear friends, today during this period of corona, many people are depressed. Many people are suffering from different things. So how it impacts on the brain, how to maintain our brain health? Our lecture will be given by our prestigious speaker, Dr. Malla Bhaskar Rao. I welcome him once again on behalf of all the participants and the WCSC Karnataka Zone. Thank you, sir. Welcome, sir.
Be blessed by the divine. At the outset, I'm thankful to Vijaya Madam and Dhanapati sir for giving me the opportunity.
Thank you, sir.
For the kind introduction. Last year, November, doctors' conference was organized at Aliyar, and I was fortunate enough to participate in that conference. And subsequently, I became a student of Sky Yoga. Usually in these meetings, Sky professors will speak to Sky students. But today, Sky student is presenting to Sky professors. With the divine blessings of Vetatri Maharshi, I hope this presentation will go on well and you will find it useful, similar to the presentation you heard about heart few days ago. If our bodies and minds are healthy and strong, not only COVID, but any other adversity in life, we can withstand. I'm not sure how many of you have seen brain surgery. For decades, this is what I've been doing. Removing a brain tumor in a young person lying on the table. Head is opened here. Using this microscope, which will illuminate and magnify the field and see, just like you have GPS in the car and GPS in the cell phone, there's a GPS here which will guide us in case of any difficulty in reaching any part, and monitor and so many gadgets. I assure you that modern brain surgery is safe and effective. Please do not worry about brain surgery. For me and for many other surgeons, doing surgery is like doing meditation. You see, it's very safe and very effective, very calm, composed act in the operating theater. As you have seen, my expertise is in taking care of people with brain diseases, as well as training young doctors in neurosurgery. But today, webinar is about brain health, wellness, well-being, and prevention. Clearly, I am not an expert in this field. I'm just making an effort to give you some idea about the overall health, and then brain, little information about brain structure, brain function, how brain evolved over a period of time, and then introduce you to some important concepts in brain regarding brain function and health, and then highlight some of the risk factors and as well as positive factors which will affect the brain health, and then give you some tips about how to maintain brain health, wellness, and also improvement, and then finally leave you with few take home messages. Health is defined by World Health Organization as a state of complete physical, mental, and social well-being, and not be merely the absence of disease or infirmity. See, first of all, this is state. So I have to attain the state and then maintain the state throughout my life. My health is not dependent on my strength and power and might alone. My health is dependent on me, my family, my workplace, healthcare providers, community in which I am living, as well as entire society at large. Please don't consider that health problems like heart attack and strokes and all those things are discrete events in time. Actually, the cause for heart attacks and strokes is atherosclerosis, accumulation of fat in the blood vessels supplying heart and brain, and this starts in early childhood, and then it takes so much time to manifest later life. So it's you have to take health as well as disease as not discrete events, but continuum and accumulation of events which we are doing. Now, coming to the topic of the day, brain function. So brain is a soft jelly like structure divided into many components, serving important function. In a newborn baby, the weight of the brain is about 1 pound, and in children it reaches 2 pounds, and in adults about 3 pounds. So on the surface there is a gray cortex, and inside there is a white matter, and there are two types of cells. Cells are like bricks in a wall. So there are two types of cells are there. One is glial cells, which are supporting, and then other thing is neurons, which are functioning units of the brain. There are 86 billion neurons are there in the human brain at birth, and each neuron is connected to several thousands of other neurons, like almost like 10,000. Each neuron is connected to 10,000 other neurons. So the connections are in trillions, and the storage capacity of the brain is 2.5 million gigabytes of digital memory. You see, you just take one cubic millimeter from anywhere in the brain, and then separate all the fiber strands in the brain. 1 millimeter, the length of that strand will be 5 kilometer. And if you remove all the connections in the brain and then put them side by side, you know the length is equal to double the length of entire Earth's diameter in one person's brain. That is the enormous connectivity in the brain. And of course, everything works by electrical, chemical, and by hormonal basis, all the functions. Now, also brain is folded inside the head and inside the skull. If these folds are made into flat, ironed into flat surface on all over, front, back, right, left, and all those things, you know, the size of the brain is 1.6 square meters. Imagine if this is the case, the size of the human head, 1.6 square meters is the flat surface area of the human brain. Now, this is the inside structure in the midline. You can see this is the nose, and this is the back of the head. So there are basically three parts. One is, this is known as forebrain. This is midbrain in the middle, and this is hindbrain. So this midbrain and hindbrain are known as brainstem. This is like computer inside the head. And so all the essential functions of the human brain are carried out in the brainstem, like control of the breathing, control of the heart, circulation, consciousness, everything is here. And whereas the forebrain receives all the information, like it from the smell, from the vision, from touch, all from hearing, all senses come to the forebrain. So based on the information it receives, as well as the experience, previous experience, it makes decisions, commands. The free will is located here in the front. So all the decisions, judgments are from the forebrain, especially from the front side of the brain, known as the frontal lobe. We spent a lot of time and effort, all of us, to look handsome and then beautiful. This doctor from Canada, Montreal, Wilder Penfield, studied the function of the each and every part of the brain almost 60-70 years ago, and then identified and then came out with this plan. If we look from the brain point of view, this is how we look. Big representation for hands, and then see the lips, tongue, and all those things. So inside, looking from outside in and inside in are different. Now, let us see how the brain and nervous system evolved. I understand that Earth was formed 4.5 billion years ago. And to cool down and to life to begin, it took almost 1 billion years. And cells formed without nucleus. And then for the cells to form with nucleus took another 1 billion years, and multicellular organisms, that means having more than one cell, took another 1 billion years. And of course, in the last 1 billion years, all the life forms, including humans, evolved. So what is required for each species was built into the brain. And no species started from the scratch. Actually, brain evolved in the later or higher species by modifying and incorporating mechanisms pre-existing in the previous species. For example, if you take rats and then cats and mice, the smell is very predominant component of the brain function. But later in the evolution, the smell has become lesser, and then there's more and more expansion of the forebrain. So today, what we do in lives, like we smile, we cry, we feel emotions, we get angry, we get happy, and then we make decisions.
Hello, sir, you have to share the slides, sir. We are not able to see the slides. PowerPoint, you have to share. Down there is an icon, sir. Share screen.
I'll stop share and then I'll restart, madam.
Yes, sir.
Madam, can I know
we are able to see, sir.
At what stage it stopped?
No, sir. From starting itself, it has not appeared on the screen.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'll just quickly go through then.
Yes, sir. Sure.
I'm really sorry. From the very beginning.
Yes, sir.
nothing was seen at all.
Yes, sir.
I really apologize for the same, and then
okay,
I.
Okay, sir. Now you can.
Last year, I was fortunate enough to attend this doctor's conference at Aliyar, and subsequently became a student of Sky Yoga. As I have mentioned earlier, today, please consider that a Sky student is speaking to the sky professors, and with the divine blessings of Vedatri Maharshi, this presentation will go on well and then will be useful to all of you. Madam, did you see this video or no? Hello?
No, sir, we didn't see, sir.
I'm not able to. Is it like new share? Can you see anything, madam?
We can see just a picture, sir. That's it.
Is it moving now?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Now it's moving.
Okay. This is just to showcase what I've been doing every day for last 30 years. Just removing a tumor in the brain. The patient is lying on the table, head is open, tumor is being removed. This is the microscope to magnify and then illuminate the field. And then just like we have GPS in the car and cell phone, this is GPS to show where exactly we are in the brain. And this is the monitor showing the brain tumor is being removed. So I just want to assure all of you that modern surgery is safe and effective, and nothing to worry about many useful operations. Operation is like doing the prayer and meditation for many of us inside this operating room. This is like our temple. So now, today, I'm not going to talk about what we do on a daily basis. We see patients, we treat diseases, we train students. But today's talk is about prevention, about wellness, about the health of the brain. So I'll just give you some idea about the brain structure, function, and how things evolved, and introduce you to some concepts like neurogenesis, and then highlight some risk and positive factors, and then give you some tips about brain health and improvement, and then leave you with few take-home messages. Madam, can you see the slides now?
Yes, hello? Sir. Yes, yes, sir.
Good. Yes, sir. So I won't spend much time then initially. So this is what we have to state means. We have to attain and then maintain the state throughout our life. So my health is dependent not only on me, but my family, my workplace, and community, and healthcare providers, and society at large. So please don't consider that health problems like stroke and heart attack are discrete events in time. At some point in old age, they happen. The commonest cause of stroke and heart attack is accumulation of fat in the blood vessels, which starts actually in early childhood. So from early childhood, it takes so many years to produce these health problems in old age. So you have to consider that health problems are in continuum and accumulation. So if you take precautions early, you will not face all the problems can be minimized. Now, regarding, madam, can you see this picture?
Yes, sir.
Oh, okay. Now, this is how a human brain looks like. It's like a soft jelly-like substance. About a pound in newborn babies, 2 pounds in children, and 3 pounds in adults. On the surface, there is a gray cortex, and inside there is a white matter. And you see the enormous power of the brain. There are 86, maybe you can remember about 100 billion neurons are there in the brain, 100 billion. And each neuron is connected to 10,000 other neurons. So the connections are in trillions, 100 trillion connections are there. And the storage capacity of the brain is about 2.5 million gigabytes. Okay, now if you just remove one millimeter cubic millimeter from this anywhere in the surface, and then remove all the connections in them and then put them side by side. 1 millimeter area, the length of the connections will be extend to 5 kilometers. And if you remove all the fibers in the brain and then put them side by side, the length is, it will encircle Earth 2 times. That is the enormous connections in the brain. And you see, brain is folded. See, just like sari is folded, and then when folded sari looks, occupies small space. Like that, brain also is folded. If you stretch, if you iron it, if it make it flat, you know, each person's human's brain in the head, it will occupy about 1.6 square meters. 1.6 square meters is the size of the brain when it is flat. Okay. Now, this is how it looks in the center, in the middle. You see nose here, eyes here, and then this is the back of the head. So there are basically 3 parts important you can divide. This whole thing is known as forebrain. This middle is known as midbrain, and this is hindbrain. So the midbrain and hindbrain are, this is brainstem. This is like a computer in the brain. This controls the heart, this controls the lungs, breathing, this controls our consciousness. And forebrain receives all the information like smell, touch, hearing, vision, and all sensory input comes to what we are seeing, what we are hearing. All things will come to the forebrain, and then forebrain, based on previous life experiences and then current sensory input, will make all the executive commands about what to do, judgments, decisions, and free will. All things are in the forebrain, especially in the frontal area, in the front. So when this Dr. Wilder Penfield from Canada, Montreal, studied each and every part of the brain almost 70 years ago. And if you look humans from inside, from brain point of view, this is how they look. The area represented is dependent upon the functional requirement of each part of the brain. Now let us see the how a brain evolved over a period of time. Earth has formed 4.5 billion years ago. It took almost 1 billion years for Earth to cool down and sustain life, and cells appeared without a nucleus. It took another 1 billion years for the cells with nuclei to form, and then another 1 billion years for cells with multiple cellular organisms to evolve. And during the last 1 billion years, subsequently all the life forms, including humans, evolved. So the madam, can you see the slide? Hello?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, sir.
Yeah, thank you. Now, the brain development did not start from the scratch in each species. It required, depending on the requirement. For example, in the rats, in the cats, in the dogs, there is a lot of requirement for smell. So that part has developed very well. Whereas it kept on changing as the evolution progressed, and humans and primate mammals evolved by modifying and incorporating mechanisms pre-existing in the previous species. So what we are now is a combination of 86 billion neurons, 100 trillion connections, structured over billions of years of evolution, and all the human years of development and learning that resulted in what we are and where we are now. Now, let me introduce some concepts regarding brain health. We have, these are the number of cells in human body, 37 trillion cells. See, we donate blood whenever it's required. If we lose a part of our skin, it will grow. And same thing will happen not only outside, even in the intestines also. Cells are lost, new cells are formed. Unfortunately, same is not the case with brain and spinal cord. this doctor, Santiago Cajal, he is the one who reported about the structure of cells in the brain, the neuron, more than 100 years ago. And for that, he got a Nobel Prize in year 1906. Okay, according to him, once brain is formed and matured, no new cells will form in the brain and spinal cord. And that his view prevailed for subsequently for many, many decades. And this Dr. Joseph Altman, he documented for the first time in 1960s that new cells are formed in rats by experiments he has proved. And this professor from Rockefeller University in New York, Fernando, he studied the brains of the songbirds. When birds learn new songs, new cells are formed in the brain. So based on all the studies, he established a connection between learning and new cell formation. Of course, now we know, and this is a study from a Swedish neurologist who documented new neuron formation in human beings for the first time based on experiments. People who were terminally ill with cancer volunteered to undergo investigations. So after they die, they donated their brains to research, and then this is how study of their brains found that new cells are formed, even humans also. Of course, now we all know that new cell formation, that is neurogenesis, happens in humans. And in fact, because of this new cell formation, even if some damage happens in our neurons in the nose on a regular basis, still new neurons are formed in the nose. Actually, we can identify 10,000 different types of smells, and 10 million neurons are there in the back of the nose to identify the smell. So you can imagine each and every function. So there are some important concepts are there. One concept is known as neuroplasticity. That means brain can change its structure and function depending upon the requirement. And similarly, there is a very important concept known as resilience. So engineering students will know that resilience means ability to return to original shape after being stretched, pressed, bent, and so on, as well as recovering from and adjusting from change. Now in psychology, the resilience refers to ability of people when exposed even to extraordinary levels of stress and trauma, like what we are undergoing during this COVID pandemic now, maintain normal psychological and physical functioning and avoid serious mental illness. That is the resilience of people. Now, there are few important structures in the human brain. One structure is known as hippocampus. You see, this is the ear, left ear, this is the left eye. So inside, just a little inside that, the structure is known as hippocampus is there. This is the amygdala, which is concerned with human emotions. And this is the hippocampus, which is concerned with human memory. Now, this is where neurogenesis happens mostly in humans. Because every day we see new things, we have to remember new things. Today, I will remember that during my presentation, the visuals are not seen for some time. You called me, and then this event will be recorded in my brain for a long time. So all this happens through the structure called hippocampus. And as we keep learning new things, like learning music, learning dance, learning a new computer program, or learning new language, new cells are formed. So learning increases new neurons, and increase of new neurons will help in learning again. So this is all plasticity, resilience, learning. And then there are two other important concepts known as cognitive reserve hypothesis. That means children who are very active in education, in sports, physical activity, and in learning multiple languages, in learning music, their brain will have like, it's like a bank balance. You have deposited money in the bank, which you can use later in whenever you need. Like that, these children have deposited new neurons because of all these skills, and this will be helpful in later in even in old age. Even if they have a head injury, even if they have a brain infection, even if they have a brain tumor, even if they become old, still this reserve will help them to recover from the diseases better than those who never practiced all those things. Madam, is it clear, my voice?
Clear, sir. Clear.
Okay, good. So these two cognitive reserve hypothesis and neurogenic reserve potential hypothesis, because these new cells are deposited and then they're dormant. They're staying, they're lying there. When there's a requirement, they'll be used. Now, it's not just one factor. You see here, multiple factors will cause loss of brain. Let me put it this way, just shrinkage of brain. Multiple factors will cause shrinkage of brain. Multiple factors will make brain growth. Okay, see, for example, here, this is Alzheimer's, dementia, Alzheimer's, this head injury and diabetes, obesity, and disturbed sleep, depression, alcohol, all these things will lead to shrinkage of the brain. Whereas here, you see diet, exercise, and antidepressant, and doing all intellectual creative things and cognitive stimulation and meditation, all this will lead to brain growth. Let us study some of these factors. Okay, now you take pregnant mothers. Some of the pregnant mothers, these studies came mostly from the West. So pregnant women who eat junk food and develop weight gain, obesity, and then a lot of metabolic disorders, when they have single mothers, obese mothers, and when they have all this anxiety, depression, and stress, that will affect the baby, fetus. And fetus, when child is born, child will have, just like mother, child will have more anxiety, more aggression, more behavioral disorders, and antisocial behavior. Okay, same thing, like children who are used to gadgets, spent whole night watching movies, watching playing video games on cell phone, computers, and then lose their sleep whole night. When they lose the sleep, see, they are subjected to all these problems as they grow, alcohol, substance, drug abuse, and all those things. So these things will help, will affect the fetus when a pregnant mother is subjected to all those diet and habits, and then also children also. Okay, a few other factors like loneliness. See, now most of the people are confined to houses because of this COVID pandemic. So people are feeling lonely. See, now I can feel that I'm just talking to a computer screen. I'm not interacting with anybody. I'm just looking at the computer screen and then talking. So I can feel terribly lonely. Alternatively, I can be connected with all of you, spread not just in Bangalore, but in Karnataka, maybe outside Karnataka. And I am communicating with you. I'm trying to convey important information and then influence your brains and then help you to improve your brain health. So if I feel that I am talking to computer screen, I feel terribly lonely. If I feel that I'm all connected to you, it's a very enriching environment for me. So both are my perception. So it all depends on how I perceive. So people who are lonely also should change their perspective, because loneliness, you know, people who are lonely, their risk of dying is much higher than alcohol and obesity and even air pollution. So people should change their perspective when they're lonely. Similarly, see, look at the poverty. Poverty is defined as income to needs ratio of less than one. And children who are in poor families, nearly 30% of mental illness in children is due to adversity. So people who are in powerful and influential positions, both governmental and non-governmental, should think about all these interventions about improving their nutritional instability, so that their brain, as they grow, they'll get better. Otherwise, some of these children can develop violent and antisocial tendencies as they grow because of poverty and all the adversities of their childhood. Okay, stress is a very important factor. See, at low levels, stress has got a positive effect, but at high levels, stress has got a negative effect. And fear, you know, when we are fearful of something, we take a lot of precautions. Immediately we either fight or we either run from that place. If you find some, for example, snake, a tiger, or if there's a fire, we run away from that place. But if the fear is sustained over a period of long time, then it becomes anxiety. And chronic stress is different. Chronic stress, when there is chronic stress, the glucocorticoids are released from the adrenal gland, and these glucocorticoids will prevent neurogenesis in the human hippocampus. So new learning will get affected. So chronic stress, people with chronic stress and depression, no neurons are formed in the hippocampus, so that will lead to deterioration in their levels. Same thing with alcohol addiction. People who are addicted to alcohol, no new neurons are formed in their brains. Suppose if they stop drinking, and then there is a robust growth of new neurons in the brain, and that's how chronic alcoholics have got learning and memory problems. Even when pregnant women they drink alcohol, of course this is mostly in Western societies, even the child, the fetus, also is gets affected by the maternal alcohol levels, and those children they develop all these attention deficit and hyperactivity disorders, and then impaired learning and then mood disorders. So even pregnant women have to take care of all these things. Similarly, drugs and smoking. See, this cannabis, initially it looks as if learning is better, so people like to take these drugs, thinking that they are helping in learning. And even smoking, people feel that their memory is slightly better when they smoke. Initially it looks, they feel like that, but once they get addicted, they'll have a significant deterioration in due course of time. Now, all things which I mentioned are risk factors, but let me share some tips or some points in favor of what helps you in improving your brain. Madam, is it clear?
Yes, sir. It is clear.
So I'm going to briefly talk about these things. One is exercise, diet, music, meditation, and sleep. There is evidence that physical exercise is beneficial for the brain health. What type of exercise, how long you have to do, and how intense is it, light or intense exercise, and what is the role of exercise in children, adolescents, adults, old age. These things are not very clear. So let us just see some evidence from the animal experiments. This is how these animal experiments are done. See, these are mice on a rotor. So when the, and these animals are subjected to a lot of investigations about their hippocampus and their formation of new neurons in their brain. and both voluntarily running as well as forced running, and then later as a part of medical experiments, of course, after obtaining ethical clearance, the animal brains are studied for this neurogenesis. And you see, this is another voluntary wheel running. See, the here the rat is running voluntarily on its own. And here you see, this is a forced exercise. See, the rats are on the treadmill. Madam, can you see?
Yes sir, clear. clear sir.
Okay, so this the different types of studies are done on voluntary wheel running, forced exercise, and regular running, irregular running, long running, short running. Different types of things are done, and eventually it was proven that those animals which run on a everyday on a fixed time, fixed duration, and fixed combination of intensity for a prolonged period have got maximum benefit in terms of neurogenesis happens in their brains. Let us see about walking. When we walk, there is a repetitive, slow, gradual movements of our body, hands, legs, and all those things. Those movements will induce this sort of electrical rhythm in the brain. This is known as theta waves. So the theta waves will help in learning better. So this is an electrophysiological equivalent of learning. Now, both rats and humans, as we age, we lose neurons. But exercises will reverse some of these loss of neurons. And if children do these things, then it will help in the old age in recovering some of these neurons. And in old people or old animals, longer, more effort is required for enhancing the neurogenesis. And those who have neurogenesis in childhood and adolescence, and even in old age, first they don't develop dementia and Alzheimer's. And even if they develop dementia and Alzheimer's, still they have like a bank balance they have. So they use the reserve neurons to remember and then process in case of any adversity. So this is a study in senior citizens who are 65 plus, that for 1 year when they walk regularly every day for 30 minutes on a daily basis for 1 year, they found a maximum benefit compared to people who do not walk. Now moving to diet, two important points I would like to highlight. One is calorie restriction. Okay. Now, if we can reduce 30% of our calorie intake, 30%, what we usually take food, if we take only 70% of that food, not 100%, 70%, for 3 months, okay, there is a 20% improvement in memory will be there. You try yourself. All of you just maintain a diary and then try yourself. This is calorie restriction. And then there is another thing called intermittent fasting. That means maintain fasting for about, say, depending on your health condition and then your fitness and maybe under medical advice, increase the gap between meal 10 hours, 12 hours, 14 hours, 16 hours. It's like you eat for 8 hours altogether and then fast for 16 hours. So it will help you in a big way. People who have, after intermittent fasting, depression has come down, anxiety has come down. Even people who have health problems like irritable bowel syndrome, their health became better. So this calorie restriction as well as intermittent fasting helps by neurogenesis. When we reduce the food intake and we fast, brain will come with new coping mechanisms. New neurons are formed and they will think and what is the issue and then why this problem is there. And then they come with a lot of coping mechanisms. So that's how these two will help. Now, there are certain food substances, they will improve memory and cognition overall. One such, the chemical substance is known as polyphenols, and they are available in these blueberries. Okay, in the blueberries, these polyphenols are available. And even in the skin of the red grapes, this chemical resveratrol is a polyphenol. It will help in improving memory. And of course, all of you know about turmeric. Turmeric has got a chemical called curcumin. Curcumin, this is we have been using for thousands of years. So this has got not only antibacterial, anti-inflammatory, and neuroprotective phenomena, but this will help in formation of new cells in the human hippocampus. Now coming to music. Music, as you know, influences from fetus to adults. We do not know exactly at a cell level how music affects all of us, but music is known to facilitate neurogenesis, and body repair, regeneration happens because of the steroids are secreted during listening to music. And music may affect genes and proteins, and music is equal to hormonal replacement therapy. Many women, when they are in mid-40s and then stop having periods, menopause, they take hormonal replacement therapy. And listening to music, I believe, is equated to hormonal replacement therapy. Of course, what type of music you would like to listen is your choice, how long and this one. Now, there are innumerable number of studies suggesting the protective effect of meditation on brain structure. For example, Madam Vijaya has taken us to enter solar system during the meditation. So the brain, part of brain known as insula, the insula will be having our own self-realization, identification. All those parts are bigger in people who are doing meditation compared to non-meditators. So the meditation will give us happiness and joy. And there are innumerable number of studies done with MRI and biochemical and clinical means with meditation. Now, sleep. Sleep is very dynamic and important part of our lives. So we do many things from morning to evening, and all these things, the important things which you have done throughout the day, they are all processed in the night during sleep and then stored as memories. That is the part of the learning. So children, students who study whole night and then go to exam without sleeping, they're actually not learning. Their memory will be there only for 2-3 days in the frontal lobe. It will not be processed through hippocampus. So sleep is very important. So you have to tell children about sleep hygiene, not to have bright lights and watching TV and then reading in the late night and watching movies and all those things. So sleep hygiene is very important. They should sleep for enough number of hours. Actually, West is considering whether the school timings have to be adjusted according to the requirement of sleep in children and adults. And so sleep is very important dynamic process. In US, elderly people are subjected to this 12-week brain fitness program. So a lot of interventions are given to these elderly people, one-to-one interventions. And then you see colored structure is hippocampus, and this structure size has improved. You see, this is before intervention, and this is after 12 weeks of intervention. The size of the hippocampus has increased even in elderly people. So that is the effect of all these fitness programs. Now I will leave you with a few take-home messages. One message is that our brains grow, learn, adapt, and heal. And diseases are not discrete events. It's not that person is healthy for 50 years, suddenly some heart attack came. Not like that. It's a health and disease are a continuum from birth to senescence till the old age. So it's a continuum and accumulation of brain and body. And it's my health is not dependent on me alone, not on my power, my strength, and all those things. It's a collective abilities of the families, workplace, and society and communities at large. And there is enough evidence that physical activity will reduce anxiety, will reduce depression, and prevent the risk of developing dementia, and will improve the sleep quality and better quality of life. So each person's brain is not only brain, life is unique. See, people who have multiple coping and learning styles, they can withstand adversities. So we have to develop all these coping strategies. And some people have greater opportunities to live a purposeful, goal striving life, and tend to rate that dimension as the most important component of their well-being. I'm sure many people belong to the Aliyar Temple of Consciousness. Sky meditation belong to this group. And those who do not have these greater opportunities to lead a purposeful and goal striving life, for those people, they consider pleasures of enjoying pleasures of daily social interaction as being the most important dimension in their lives. Final message is that your brain, use it or lose it. Okay. Brains are extraordinarily plastic and responsive, and they have resilience. Just like how we lose muscle power in old age, we lose brain power also. But same way, just like how physical exercise helps in maintaining physical health, mental exercise and all the tips I gave will help you in maintaining the brain and mental health also. This is my last slide. Madam, can you see?
Yes, sir.
Good. So this is my last slide. This is a small exercise. You can do leisurely at home at your convenient time. So we have four components in our four domains in our life. One is our physical life. Second one is our life with families and society. And third is our profession, working area. And the fourth one is spiritual. So this is like looking like a perfect sphere. You draw for yourself on a piece of paper. You see how much time you're spending, attention, energy, time you're spending for your profession, how much you're spending for spirituality, how much you're spending for society, how much you're spending for yourself. See, for me and for many doctors, it's something like this. A lot of time with work, very little time with family, and very little time for spirituality, a lot of time with professional. So you draw for yourself and then see how the figure looks like, Of course, this is considered ideal that we have equal importance to our personal and family and profession. And spirituality is an integral part of each and every domain of these all these aspects. And finally, I thank you very much for the opportunity given. I feel really good speaking to all of you, and I apologize for the technical glitch which I didn't realize till madam told me. I'll be happy to answer, clarify any questions if you have regarding my presentation of the data. If you have if you want a very detailed explanations, my email is available with madam as well, as it's there in the first slide, and I'll be very happy to answer all the questions, even if they're unrelated to this presentation. You can send a mail through the Sky Yoga Bangalore chapter, and then I'll be happy to answer. And thank you very much once again.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Yes, madam.
Wanted to tell something, sir.
Yeah, I'll be happy to answer the questions.
Yes, sir. Sir, you made us understand that there is a part called brain in our head. Many aspects about the brain, its structure, functions, growth, and how to keep it well, wellness of the brain. Very nice, very neatly explained, sir, in an order. Very beautifully arranged the slides, sir. Very, very much thank you, sir. Some people are ready to ask some questions, sir. They'll raise the hand and they'll just ask you, sir.
Yes, madam. Can
we continue, ma'am?
Yes, ma'am. Now it's the time for question and answer sessions. Those who want to ask the questions regarding today's speech, please click on the raise hand button and ask your questions. First, Chandrika Raja, madam, unmute yourself and ask the question, madam.
Thank you very much, sir. Your talk was very interesting and you have filled our brain with lots of important information. But I want one question to ask you. We senior citizens, as you said, 70%, if you eat 70% of food for 3 months, your memory will improve by 20%.
Yes.
We senior citizens, our intake of food itself is, less. And in our cases, do you think this will help us? Because sometimes our memory power is bad.
The question is, you want to expand that point, that how it happens, or to protect memory or to reverse?
Is it possible for us? The thing is, if we senior citizen,
yes, ma'am.
If your intake is only 70%, yes, do you think we will be able to improve our memory power? Because our intake is already less.
Probably with people with serious health problems like cardiac diabetic, of course they have to take medical advice before resorting to any diet calorie reduction. But this is proven experimental studies involving humans as well as non-human forms, that neurogenesis happens in people with the caloric reduction. I think exact requirement of diet, the quantity is not specific. If food is very tasty, or if there is some sort of celebration, we tend to eat more if there's plenty of food at home, variety of food. Food is less, so that eating more is actually harms the body. When there is more food, I'm not talking about stroke and heart attack and diabetes. it will reduce the neurogenesis.
Yeah.
So this it's like a toxic to the body. It's more than what body can metabolize. So all that will get deposited and then it will be toxic. So the reverse happens with obesity will cause a lot of problems. Obesity, you can see grossly. Okay. You can see grossly. See, obese people cannot walk. Obese people have got a lot of problem, cardiac problem. So if you look at carefully at minute level at the brain hippocampal point of view, they have reduction the hippocampal neurogenesis, new cell formation. So of course you can maintain a diary. You see how well you are remembering people, events, and numbers and all those things, and then try to reduce the see the reduction the die. And then after 3 months, suppose if you are happy with the progress, you can continue. Suppose if you develop any hypoglycemic attack anytime, that means you are feeling giddy, you are feeling weak, you are feeling tired, then maybe food you are taking, maybe it has to be increased. So it has to be adjusted. Each person has to try on their own how things go on. If required, maybe you can check with the dietitian what to take, what not to take, all those things. Dietitians give actually, according to body height, weight, and metabolism, they'll give a fixed caloric requirement. You need 2000 calories, you need 1500 calories, like that. So based on that, you can calculate how much you can reduce. Normally, when we eat at home, we don't take care of all those things.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Yeah, yeah, sure.
Thank you. We'll go on with the next question, sir. Velu Swami, sir.
Yes, ma'am.
Velu Swami, sir, unmute yourself and ask the question, sir.
Next one.
Emalata? Emalata, madam, unmute yourself and ask the question.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Sir, you were talking about that numerology, right? Which part of the brain makes people stress more? Because I professionally, by work, I'm an engineer.
Okay.
I spoke with the engineering, a lot of thinking will go through and a lot of impacts will be there, okay. As you were saying, right?
Yeah. Now, I try to make it as simple as possible.
Hmm.
I spoke about brainstem.
Right.
Which controls the heart and breathing and consciousness. I spoke about the forebrain, which is like an executive center. Okay, in between these two, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Yeah. In between these two, there is a system called limbic system.
Okay.
Limbic system has got several structures, but that is like a ring inside the brain. And the limbic system, two important parts of limbic system. One part is known as amygdala.
Mm-hmm.
Another part is known as hippocampus.
Okay.
So amygdala is concerned with human emotions.
Fine.
Yeah, I'll just give you a small example. When you go from your house to office,
yes,
daily, you see so many people, vehicle, and some vehicles come in the opposite direction, some come from the behind very fast, very slow. You have to plan and negotiate and navigate so many things.
Right. Sometimes even if you are driving a safer side, people will still go through certain accidents. Yeah,
but your brain is very active, taking care of all those things.
Right.
But next day, you don't remember all those things.
Yeah. Most of the 90%, I don't remember. That's
but
true.
But suppose while same day you're going from house to office, you find a tiger on the road.
Right.
Or you find an accident in one junction.
Hmm.
Every day you go on that junction.
We remember that.
Remember that accident, because amygdala, amygdala tells hippocampus that there is a risk to life. Store it. So store this important information, because see, there are only two biological important biological purposes are there in human life or all animal life. One is you survive. Second, you procreate. So this any whenever there is a harm to body,
yeah,
it is recorded, it's encoded. Amygdala tells hippocampus to store, so for years together you will not forget.
Right. Is it stores in an image format or is it
ultimately it's in protein form. It makes a changes in the synaptic junctions. Like there is a neuron which is connected to 10,000 other neurons. That connection is known as synapse.
Yeah.
So there are changes in the protein structure and the synaptic junctions. That's how all the information is stored in the brain.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Next, Velu Swami, sir. Please
ask. Madam, Baliya Samruddhi and the A. Be blessed by the are you hearing, madam?
Yes, sir. Yeah.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Yes, you can ask, sir.
Sir?
Kelly, sir. Kelly. Question, Kelly.
Sir, yes, sir. I read some paper in one doctor has cured her husband the Alzheimer's disease only by using the entirely by the this coconut oil. Whereas yes, at present days in India, almost all the doctors, specialists are telling not to use this coconut oil because it is having a lot of cholesterol. This two are controversy, but that lady doctor has proved and released a research paper saying that this coconut, only by using everything by coconut oil, she has cured her husband completely.
Yes, sir.
Who was having a severe Alzheimer's disease.
Yes,
can
sir.
You throw some light on this, sir?
Yes, sir. More than me, Google will throw the light, sir.
sir.
You have to do three. I'll break your question into three parts, sir.
Sir,
one thing is, you please do research on Google about coconut oil. Actually, there is a worldwide, there is a big fight between sugar and fat. All over the world, there is a big fight going on between sugar industry and fat industry.
Sir.
Because the medicines which are made to lower sugar, lower cholesterol, they are in thousands of crores. It's a big business for the companies. So sugar industry and fat industry, they're fighting with each other for decades. That is one. When you come to fat, there are different opinions regarding coconut oil.
Yes, sir.
So you have to do Google search for more information on coconut oil. That is one. Second, regarding Alzheimer's disease, also you have to do Google search. And third thing is this lady recovering from Alzheimer's.
Yeah.
Sir, this is a personal story.
Sir.
So if let us assume that it is correct. Suppose if she gets a lot of money in a lottery, you and I won't get it. So
okay, sir.
Personal stories are not applicable to generally others.
Yeah.
If her story is correct, we don't know what happened in her life. We don't, because we are talking about a person whom we have known anything. We do not know anything. Okay, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Next question from Devraj Acharya, sir. Please unmute yourself, sir. Good. Devraj Acharya, sir. Please unmute yourself and ask the question, sir.
Next.
Arunatharan, sir. Please unmute yourself, sir.
Hello. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir. Kelly, sir.
Sir, first, thank you very much for your nice lecture, sir. Really, I am happy to see you and hear your voice.
Thank you.
And I want to small one question. You are told our exercise, I won't say our exercise, it is exercise is required and meditation is required. Food also we have to take care. Like that for our mind health, you have given some points.
Yes, sir.
Now you have seen our exercise pattern and our meditation pattern also you have seen.
Yes, sir.
What is your feedback, sir, about our exercise and our meditation?
I have tried several types of exercises. I've been trying from my childhood.
Yeah.
And now I'm 61.
Yeah.
And I found the Sky Yoga program very good for my health. There is no stress on my heart. There is no stress on my joints. I could able to comfortably do in half an hour. I can do the exercise, and then probably it is not just taking care of. See, if you run, leg muscles definitely will become stronger. But the one I am learning from Sky Yoga is actually activates each and every part of the body and brain.
Yeah.
I am very happy, and then I encourage many people to take it up. But of course, young people may want to jump up and down.
Yeah.
Because their bodies are more flexible.
Yeah.
People who are involved heavily into sports.
Yes.
They like to do more cardio and muscle strengthening exercises at their age.
Yeah.
I think they can practice this also. They can practice all. Maybe one has to try what suits to one's body and mind.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Devraj Acharya, sir. He unmuted. Okay. Dr. Chandrasekhar, sir. Please unmute yourself and ask the question, sir.
Yeah. Good evening, sir. It was a good presentation. After a long time, we got refreshed with a lot of things. Sir, a quick one. You were saying about intermittent fasting, right, sir? That would enhance the neurogenesis.
Yes, sir.
Sir, what kind of fasting? Like a complete fasting, or can we sip teas with that? Like tea once, like 2-3 teas?
Like there are exercise, there are so many variations. Fasting also has got so many variations.
Okay.
Across the religions, maybe all the religions.
Okay.
Practice fasting, it has been going on for centuries.
Yes, sir.
Now, many people in modern life have diabetes.
Yes, sir.
Very stressful lives, and then irregular working schedules and night shifts and all those things.
Yes, sir.
So our brains are evolved and probably they're unhappy with our lifestyles now.
Mm-hmm.
Now, coming to your question specifically.
Yes, sir.
You have to try what suits you best.
Okay.
Some people known to me,
mm-hmm.
they practice this 8-16.
Okay.
8-16 means, suppose you have your breakfast at 9 o'clock.
Okay.
You will finish your meal by evening, say 5 o'clock or something.
Okay.
And then from evening 5 to next day morning 9 o'clock.
Okay.
No food. No food.
Okay.
So what your body requires, the nourishment, is taken from morning breakfast to evening, early evening food by 5 o'clock, something like that.
Okay.
So you will be fasting from evening to next day morning.
Yes, sir.
But you have already taken your required nourishment. So you will not develop hypoglycemia.
Okay.
So this is one practical way. Some people eat one day regularly, other day they don't eat.
Okay.
So there are different ways and means. Maybe you should see what is more suitable to you.
No, my question is, sir, in between, is there nothing to allowed or except water, or how is
it? It's your choice which you have to make. It's not, nobody is allowing or not allowing.
What is the ideal way? Like, I mean, how which will have a better impact? Yeah.
You volunteered to attend this webinar.
Yes, sir.
You volunteered to have a diet for intermittent fasting as per your choice.
Okay.
It's not that allowed or not allowed. Suppose I believe hunger pranks will be there for 72 hours.
Yes, yes.
When people don't eat from evening 5 to next morning 9,
mm-hmm.
they'll feel hungry for 3 days.
Yes, sir. Afterwards, you won't feel it.
4th day onwards, they won't feel any hunger pranks. I mean, yes. they'll feel good. They'll lose all excess weight. Their yes. brains will be sharp.
Yes.
So, sir, if I think this presentation should not be confined only to talking.
Yes, sir.
If people like you,
yes, sir.
If you actually practice and then share your experience.
Yes, sir. I agree with that because I fast for nearly 6 days for Kandha Shashti without taking anything, only water.
So you can tell us more than now.
And every week, nearly 20 hours, I fast like on Saturdays. Today, last night I had a dinner and now I'm going to have a dinner. Yes. So only in between, I'll have two times tea maybe. If I'm in work, I forget that also.
Yes, sir.
At home, I'll have like 2 or 3 teas. That's why I'm asking whether that is also, that's okay or will it have any different impact?
But
as you said, like after 3rd day, when I was fasting for 6 to 7 days during Kandha Shashti, I feel much better than first 3 days, last 3 days.
You know that my presentation is correct, sir.
Yes, yes, of course. That's why I just wanted to check.
Yes, sir.
That 6 days, it is very strict, like without having any tea or anything like that.
Yes, sir.
So maybe last 1 or 2 days, mm-hmm. I'll have like a little bit of honey water or one coconut water like that, because it shouldn't go too much dehydrated also.
Yes, sir.
But it makes a lot of difference at the last 3 days than the first 3 days.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
But that is experience. But the first one is every week I'm having this fasting for 20 hours on yes, Saturday.
Yes,
but
sir.
By not having tea, will it have any better impact based on your researches or whatever?
You try yourself. we only talk, but you're actually practicing.
Yeah.
You're better than us.
Thank you very much. The next question from Yashoda madam. Please unmute yourself and ask the question, ma'am.
ಬಾಳಿಗೆ ಸಮೃದ್ಧಿ ಎಂದಿಗೆ ಸರ್
ಹಲೋ
ಸರ್ ಐ ಆಮ್ ಸ್ಟಡಿಂಗ್ ಇನ್ 8th ಸ್ಟ್ಯಾಂಡರ್ಡ್
ಓ ವೆರಿ ಗುಡ್
ಐ ಆಮ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ಕೂರ್ಗ್ ಹಲೋ
ಪ್ಲೀಸ್ ಟೆಲ್ ಮೀ
ಆಸ್ಕ್ ಯುವರ್ ಕ್ವೆಶ್ಚನ್ ಪಾ
ಯೆಸ್ ಪ್ಲೀಸ್
ಹೌ ಮೆನಿ ಅವರ್ಸ್ ಶುಡ್ ರೀಡ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಹೌ ಮೆನಿ ಅವರ್ಸ್ ಶುಡ್ ಸ್ಲೀಪ್ ಸರ್
ಯಾ ಯು ಆರ್ ಇನ್ 8th ಸ್ಟ್ಯಾಂಡರ್ಡ್
ಯೆಸ್ ಸರ್
Sleep for 8 hours.
8 hours?
8 hours, madam. Because you're 8 years, you're in 8th standard.
Yes, sir.
No, I'm just kidding. See, there is no fixed time. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Morning when you get up.
Yes, sir.
If you feel tired.
Yes, sir.
Sleepy.
Yeah.
Not interested in going to school.
Okay, sir.
That means you didn't sleep properly.
Oh.
Morning when you get up, you're fresh, energetic, jumping. You want to go to school and learn so many things.
Oh, yes, sir.
That means you slept well.
Sir, another question.
No, I not completed.
Okay, sir.
So your body will tell you.
Yes, sir.
Your body will tell you whether the sleep was adequate or not. Doctor will not tell.
Yeah.
Outsider will not tell.
Yeah.
Your body only will tell. So best thing is to finish all your studies and everything and then go to bed by around 10 o'clock in the night.
Yes,
and then get up at morning 6 o'clock or so. And then make it a regular habit. You have one more question.
Sir, for a few months back, I had headache and sir.
Headache.
Yes, sir. It will come for 5 days. Other days also.
Okay.
When it will come, I can't stand, sir. Why?
Headache has got many reasons.
And I will get to vomit.
Yeah, headache has got many reasons.
Yes, sir.
Actually, headache won't come from brain.
Oh, okay, sir.
Headache comes from the eyes, nose, mouth, teeth, jaws, ears, all those things outside.
Okay, sir.
Not from inside, not in the brain.
Yes, sir.
Most of the people with headache, I've got no serious problem and nothing to worry.
But thank you, sir.
But I suggest you to consult a pediatrician. Hello?
Yes, sir. Please yes, sir.
Yeah, I suggest you to consult a doctor, a pediatrician, and then find out what is the cause of your headache. If you can identify, you can treat. Like some people, they need spectacles. Some people need dental care. Some people have to check their hemoglobin. Sometimes it is, I don't know, but sometimes it is related to menstrual cycles. So many issues are there. So you have to check with the doctor about whether doctor can identify the cause of your headache and then treat.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, you also can identify while eating any food, while not sleeping, while watching something. If anything is causes there, you identify and then avoid it. And vomiting, of course, is a concern why you get vomiting. So better to consult a doctor and then clarify if there's any problem. Okay?
Okay, sir. Thank you. Shall we move on to the next question, sir?
Sure.
Shailaja, madam, unmute yourself and ask the question, madam. Devraj Acharya, sir, unmute yourself and ask the question, sir. Shailaja, madam. Devraj Acharya, sir, unmute yourself, sir.
Next one, Karthik, Karthik. Hello.
Hello.
Madam,
hello?
If there is a problem, I can reply through email also later.
Okay, sir. Okay, sir.
If it is getting late for the program. All questions will be answered by email.
Sir, one quick question, sir.
Hello, Karthik.
Yeah.
Please ask, sir.
Yeah. Thank you for the wonderful presentation, sir. Yeah. So the question is, you've been telling us that the human brain or the animal brain has evolved over a period of time, and it has evolved in a way that it can process data which is required for survival, right? So on the same lines, if the monotic life of the current generation is filled with stress and lifestyle disorders, is there a way in which the human brain will evolve to counter these negative impacts?
Future predictions are highly inaccurate, I believe. Brain has got coping mechanisms. So when things go wrong, brain has got coping mechanisms, and then when coping mechanisms fail, people resort to all sorts of negative things. Can you hear me? Karthik?
Yes, sir.
Those who, first of all, who do not have coping mechanisms like resilience and plasticity and cognitive neurogenic reserve, they are vulnerable to effects of depression and drugs and suicidal tendencies. Probably some of the people who succumb to the psychological pressure and then commit suicides, they do not have any coping mechanisms. There are others who are equally subjected to these problems in families, in professions, in business, in life. They are also subjected to a lot of problems, but they have multiple coping mechanisms. So they manage these things. So only thing is we have to realize what is harming us and what is helping us. Suppose if there are friends are there, and if their friends are helping us to come out of depression, friends are helping us to improve in life, so we should spend more time with them and then take their help. Suppose if friends are causing others are causing harm to us, making us addicted to alcohol and other things, maybe we try to avoid them. And evolutionary changes take hundreds and thousands of years. They will not happen from one generation to the next generation, but they're all changes are bound to happen. See, we use it to, before learning writing, we use it to use thumb impression for signatures and all, instead of signatures. Now we learned how to write, and now we are again back to thumb with WhatsApp and Blackberries and all those things. So again, lot of changes are happening in our brains. See, brain changes based on our habits. In London, if somebody has to pass a driving license for a taxi, the person has to know all the roads, by heart all the roads in London. And those people who know all the roads, when their brains are studied, they have a bigger hippocampi. And the jugglers, people who throw balls, the jugglers have got changes in the brain. And students who study for the exams, they have changes in the brain. So changes do happen in the brain, and then these are all documented with brain imaging studies. Again, probably because we are using our thumbs a lot more with gadgets, the thumb area in the brain will increase. For us also, if you do MRI studies, thumb areas will increase with all this habituation. But evolutionary changes are time taking. They take hundreds and thousands of years. Thank you, Karthik. If you have any specific things, you please send a mail. I will try to reply.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your answers, sir. We'll wind up, sir.
Yes, madam. Yes, ma'am. I think there is something, but I can answer through email if they have. They can write to you.
Yes, sir.
They can write to you. And you can reply through you.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Surely, sir. Surely. Sure, sir.
Thank you very much for the opportunity given.
Yes, sir. I'll just bless you, sir. After that, you can leave. We'll end the program, sir.
Yes, yes, ma'am.
Balge Bhumandala, Balge Bhumandala, Balge Samruti Yondige, Atmiya Snehitare, Ishtattu Namma Jotheli, Namma Jotheli Iddu, Namma Midulina Bagge, Ishtella, Vishayagalanna Telisikottanta, Dr. Mallabhaskar, sir, avarna navellaru harisona. Let us bless him. Dr. Mallabhaskar, sir, avaru avara kutumba, Balge Samruti Yondige, ಅವರ ಆಧ್ಯಾತ್ಮಿಕ ಸೇವೆ ಬಾಳಿಗೆ ಸಮೃದ್ಧಿಯೊಂದಿಗೆ ಅವರ ದೇಹ ಆರೋಗ್ಯ ಬಾಳಿಗೆ ಸಮೃದ್ಧಿಯೊಂದಿಗೆ ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು ವೆರಿ ಮಚ್ ಸರ್ ಸರ್ ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು ಫಾರ್ ದ ವ್ಯಾಲ್ಯೂಬಲ್ ಫೀಡ್ಬ್ಯಾಕ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಯು ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಗಿವನ್ ಸರ್ ಡ್ಯೂರಿಂಗ್ ದಿಸ್ ಪ್ರೋಗ್ರಾಮ್ ಅಬೌಟ್ ಸ್ಕೈ ಯೋಗ ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು ವೆರಿ ಮಚ್ ಸರ್
ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು
ವೆರಿ ಮಚ್ ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು ಸರ್ ಪಲ್ಲವಿ ಲೈನ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಇದ್ದೀರಮ್ಮ ಹಲೋ ಬಾಳಿಗೆ ಸಮೃದ್ಧಿಯೊಂದಿಗೆ ಇಲ್ಲಿನ ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮವನ್ನು ಇಲ್ಲಿಗೆ ಮುಗಿಸಿಕೊಳ್ಳೋಣ ವಿಶ್ವಶಾಂತಿ ಪ್ರಾರ್ಥನೆಯೊಂದಿಗೆ ವಿಶ್ವ ಕೈಲಾಸ ಕಾಲಿಕ ಮಳೆ ಸಾಕಷ್ಟು ಸುರಿಯಲಿ ರೈತರೆಲ್ಲ ಧಾನ್ಯವನ್ನು ಹುಮಸಿನಿಂದ ಬೆಳೆಯಲಿ ಹಲವು ಉದ್ಯೋಗಗಳ ಮಾಡುತ್ತಿರುವ ಕಾರ್ಮಿಕರು ಉನ್ನತಿಯಾಗಲಿ ವಿವಿಧತೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಏಕತೆ ಕಾಣುವ ಸಂಸ್ಕೃತಿಯನ್ನು ಉತ್ತಮವಾಗಿಸಲಿ ಕಲಹಗಳು ಪೈಪೋಟಿ ಹಗೆತನ ಮೀರಿದ ಆಡಳಿತ ನಡೆಯಲಿ ಅನಕ್ಷರತೆ ಸಾಲ ಬಡತನ ಕಳಂಕಗಳು ಮರೆಯಾಗಲಿ
ಸುಖ ಬಾಳನ್ನು ನೀಡುವ ಸತ್ಯ ಜ್ಞಾನ ಜ್ಯೋತಿ ಬೀರಲಿ ನಮ್ಮ ಕರ್ತವ್ಯ ಧಾರ್ಮಿಕ ಬಾಳ್ವೆಯ ಗುರಿಯನ್ನೇ ಉತ್ತಮವಾಗಿಸಲಿ ನಮ್ಮ ಕರ್ತವ್ಯ ಧಾರ್ಮಿಕ ಬಾಳ್ವೆಯ ಗುರಿಯನ್ನೇ ಉತ್ತಮವಾಗಿಸಲಿ ನಮ್ಮ ಕರ್ತವ್ಯ ಧಾರ್ಮಿಕ ಬಾಳ್ವೆಯ ಗುರಿಯನ್ನೇ ಉತ್ತಮವಾಗಿಸಲಿ ಬಾಳ್ಗೆ ಭೂಮಂಡಲ ಬಾಳ್ಗೆ ಭೂಮಂಡಲ ಬಾಳ್ಗೆ ಸಮೃದ್ಧಿಯೊಂದಿಗೆ ಶಾಂತಿ ಶಾಂತಿ ಶಾಂತಿ